I hate riding in planes. Please note, I didn't say that I hate flying. When you're trying to make people laugh, choosing hating flying as a topic is pretty thin soup. I actually like flying in the being way up in the air part. In March of 1997, my wife and I, we flew to Europe on our honeymoon, just as the Hale-Bopp comet was arriving to pick up those cultists. And we saw it from 35,000 feet with crystal clear skies. It was glorious. And it looked like every special effect movie featuring a comet about to hit the Earth. So, I like flying, but I hate riding in planes. That's still thin soup, mind you, but hopefully it's a more specific thin soup, like cream of water or something. Airports are bad enough. And the happy no-shoe dancing TSA grope fest doesn't help at all. Because inevitably you have to deal with people who don't fly often enough to know how the dance goes. I went through LAX once, and for those who don't know, LAX is not praised for its lighthearted view of airline security protocols. The TSA agents are all standing there, like the Gorn from Star Trek. You don't joke around with Gorn. You just don't. The people in front of me during this particular trip was an older couple from Canada and had just connected in LAX returning home from some trip to Texas. Further, they had not flown in the United States since 9/11. You might wonder how I know this. Well, when they got to the security scanner and the Gorn dude is droning on and on about 3 ounces of liquid in a baggie on the plane, hern. The couple calls him over. Apparently, during their layover, this couple had gone shopping at a market in L.A. She states to the Gorn that they brought some salsa and things at the local market. What should she do? He asks her to open the carry-on bag, which is one of those probably a little too big to qualify as carry-on, but screw it, okay, roller bags. She unzips it to reveal it is jam-packed with unlabeled clear jars filled with substances alternating from a clear, bright green translucent gel to a bright solid red fluid. It looks, to anyone who has ever seen a movie featuring one, like a convoluted bomb. You know, the ones that feature two types of thick liquids that are separated, then the timer goes off and they start to mix, and that means Nicolas Cage has like 15 seconds to diffuse it. And invariably the liquids in these movie bombs are green and red in color. Jalapeno jelly, in this case, is the green gel, and homemade salsa is the red one. So, while the only type of explosion the contents of this suitcase are going to cause is going to be in the bathroom at some point, the Gorn still have to check everything. As soon as she unzipped the bag and opened it, there were two levels of groans. One from everyone in the line who knew this meant we had to wait while it got sorted, and the groan from the TSA Gorn who knew that although obviously a bomber would never voluntarily offer up this bag, therefore the contents were harmless, he was still going to have to do all the work to make sure the security theater rules were observed. This stuff happens to me all the time. If there's a line where someone didn't know about the shoe rule and wants to argue about it, I'm in it. If there's a checkpoint with someone who insists an iPad is not a laptop, and therefore they don't have to remove it from the bag, that's me. If there's a couple who bought 25 jars of homemade unlabeled liquids arranged in a bag to look exactly like a bomb in a John McTiernan film, hey, welcome to Stepto Town. So airports themselves are unpleasant. We know this. Now, airplanes. You're in a relatively tiny metal tube with a lot of your fellow humans. The door is shut, and they're about to take off. All the lights go off except the overhead light, your own personal spotlight shining on your head. This always makes me feel like I'm in a CIA rendition room and they're going to ask me where the bomb is, and I don't know where it is, okay? Ask the lady with all the salsa. So now you're in the air. Oh, confession time, by the way. I kind of feign sleep during takeoff, hoping to come off like Hicks and Aliens. Now, this is going to shock you, but when it comes to communal situations, I tend towards being a socially awkward penguin, especially when I know I'm going to be cramped and uncomfortable, and there's a chance, however infinitesimally small, that these might be my last moments on Earth. The very nature of an airplane means that you're going to be exposed to different types of flyers. For your benefit, I have categorized them. The most common one you will find is what I call the mouth of Sauron. When I fly, I have two modes. Eyes closed, waiting to be told when I can use my electronic devices, or using my electronic devices. When flying, I either play games or I read on my laptop or iPad. The mouth of Sauron sees this, sees that I am attempting to either try to sleep or that I'm concentrating on some type of time passing activity, and yet will not stop attempting to engage me in conversation. The most frustrating thing about the mouth of Sauron is that they assume that any rebuff of their advances means they're just simply not trying the right topics. So my single-syllable answers or grunts in response to their ever-shifting topics, "Where are you from? What do you do for a living? Do you have kids? Is this your first time to Boise?" All that just bounces off of them. There's no way to deal with a mouth of Sauron with any finality without being rude. The one time I tried to be polite and say, "I'm sorry, I'm really into this book and want to read right now," I had a mouth of Sauron reply. No joke. "Oh, not a talker, huh? Well, I'll do the talking for both of us." You know what does work? Murmuring, "Murder is illegal. Murder is illegal. Murder is especially illegal on an airplane," under your breath. Another denizen that you will encounter on airplanes is one I like to call the walking plague. This is a person who is not only sick, but obviously feverish. This is an incredibly irresponsible condition to fly in, and I'm not sure why airlines allow it, but more than once I've seen them in the boarding area, flushed and bundled up, sniffling into a Kleenex, and more than once I've sat next to a member of the walking plague and then a week later cursed them as my body turned into a rich, natural resource of phlegm. It doesn't take too many flights a year to run into Judge Dredd. Judge Dredd is the person who believes the airline's rules are stupid and arbitrary and has to make a show of either breaking them to the point of being told to stop it or argue them as if on this one flight, this one shining moment, the airline will relent and allow him to use his cell phone to make a call while the plane is landing. "Sir, please turn off your device." "Sure, sure, in a minute." I've even seen a guy turn his device off. Then, once the flight attendant walked away, he turned it back on. Then put it in the seat pouch. He didn't even use it. He just wanted to break the rules. "Way to go, Mr. I am the law." Look, I agree that most of the in-flight electronic rules are dumb, but in the off chance they aren't, I can put up with 15 minutes without a Kindle until we reach 10,000 feet. The last airplane denizen I will cover here is the encroacher. The encroacher, either through bad etiquette or sheer physical size, cannot confine themselves to their seat boundaries. Now, I'm a big guy. I mean, as of my talking about this, I'm 6'2", 230. So yeah, I should definitely lose some weight. But I do fit in an airplane seat without crowding anyone else. If the encroacher isn't crossing the seat boundaries due to sheer physical size, then they're an armrest hog, or, at worst, a leaner. For the life of me, I will never understand the person who just nonchalantly curls up against a complete stranger. Either I have physical contact issues, or, more likely, this person is a creepy weirdo who probably has a murder room in their basement. Sometimes, however, you can see these denizens impact each other without impacting you. My ideal flight is me on the aisle seat in an empty row, and in the aisle next to me is Judge Dredd, trapped in the middle between an encroacher on the aisle seat and the walking plague on the window. Now, having said all of this, I propose some rules. I think they're fair. Rule number one. If you are in the aisle seat, you will, without comment or complaint, always get up for the middle and window people to walk around or go to the bathroom, even if you're napping on the flight. This is because you have the best seat. Note that this assumes that the other two people don't get up every 5 minutes. Rule number two. If you are in the window or aisle seat, you cede your middle armrest to the person in the middle seat. They have a terrible seat, and you both get more room than that person. Number three. If you are in the middle and the aisle seat is occupied, and the window seat is unclaimed upon takeoff, you move from the middle to the window to give both passengers more room. You also put your below seat bag under your new window seat so that both passengers can stretch their legs into the middle below seat slot. Number four. If you have a screaming newborn less than 18 months old, you will look contrite and apologize. You will not glare offensively at all the other passengers, as if you have the God-given right to bring a creature less than 18 months old on an airplane, a creature that cannot cope with the noise and the cabin pressure without screaming. I'm sorry your family refuses to come visit you, but it's kind of a bad situation for all of us. Everyone loses here. So try to at least not act like you're the put-upon party in this scenario. Rule number five. Do not cuddle or lean on people you are not related to or do not sleep with. Seriously, why do I have to even have this rule? Rule number six. I know, Judge Dredd. Deep down, you think the airline rules are stupid regarding e-readers and iPads and computer use during takeoff and landing. Hell, I tend to agree. But the reality is that the rules are in place and we all have to deal. So if you whip out your cell phone while we're trying to get off the runway under the guise of these stupid people don't understand electronics and they do not have to obey their rules, don't complain if I beat you within an inch of your goddamn life with your own cell phone for potentially endangering us all. Rule number seven. Do not watch porn on the airplane. Hey, look, I'm a big fan of porn. Have no problem with it in general. But, like, clipping my toenails? Everything has a time and a place. I don't care if you have the porn version of an all-you-can-eat Netflix queue. I do not want to look up from my crappy Kindle Impulse purchase of a Dean R. Kuntz book to see Jenna Chesty Boobs nom-nom-nomming on Peter McPork Sausage's magical marble sack on your compensating-for-something-else Dell 20-inch laptop one seat ahead of me. Rule number eight. On the order of your fourth alcoholic beverage, when the flight attendant says, nope, you can't have any more, if you still persist on belligerently ordering one more, I will pipe up from next to you and say, hey, he told me earlier he had a gun in his cocaine pack strapped near his heroin bags. The proper response to make everyone feel better when a flight attendant says they can't serve you any more alcohol is, oh, okay, I'll just take a water then. Bam. Everyone is happy. Know when to say when. Rule number 9. Seriously, Judge Dredd, I will punch your ass in the neck over and over again until you put the stupid device away while we land. Do not tempt me. I feel these are simple rules. Can't we all follow them? I think we can.